So I was asked to talk about the intestinal microbiome and where does it fit with the clinical management of our patients. And so what I would like to do in the next 20 minutes is that I'll go over the intestinal microbiota, just a very short overview. We'll address several questions. What do we know about the intestinal microbiota in GI disorders? Can the intestinal microbiota be targeted in the treatment of GI disorders? What should be considered, who should be considered for interventions targeting the intestinal microbiota? And I will conclude and give you my personal perspectives on this. So the intestinal microbiota, the microbiota colonizes every surface of the human body that is exposed to the external environment. The GI tract contains more or most of the bacteria, about 70% of the microbes. With the exception of specific pathogen, it is pretty much agreed that the microbiota is important in maintaining human health. The intestinal microbiota change as you go from the proximal GI to the distal GI tract. So in the proximal part, you have very few bacteria, mostly aerobes, and as you go distally, you see more anaerobic bacteria and a significant higher load. When we talk about the intestinal microbiota, we also need to remember that there are two different niches. One is the luminal microbiota. These are the transient bacteria within the lumen. And the other microenvironment is in the biofilm just attached to the intestinal epithelium. We address them, or we call them, the mucosal-associated microbiota. And both or each of them may have a potentially a different function. Here is the results of a recent study that we did looking at the fecal and mucosal microbiota using high throughput sequencing, showing significant differences between the mucosa microbiota and the feces microbiota. You can see that they separate very well on principal component analysis, and there are also differences in the enrichment or diversity of the bacteria with higher diversity in the feces compared to the mucosa. We also need to remember that the microbiota change over time. For example, this is a recent study that we did comparing children and adults, showing that children had much lower diversity, and we build the diversity or the richness of our microbiota as we grow up. We can see clear separation between the microbiotas of children, even at the age of 4, and adults, meaning that unlike what we thought before, that the microbiota is already established around the age of first year of life, we know that they are still not completely established or reach the adult-like pattern, even at the age of 4 and 5. So to summarize this past, the intestinal microbiota changes as you moved from proximal to distal GI, from the epithelium to the lumen, and from birth to death. Now, I'm frequently being asked, can we define a healthy microbiome or healthy microbiota? And currently, there is no accepted description for a healthy gut microbiota. The microbiota can be described in terms of desirable composition, that means who is there, function, what they are doing there, ecologic stability, this is the ability to resist changes under stress, like change in diet or exposure to antibiotics, and resilience, which is the ability to return to baseline following stress conditions. What do we know about the intestinal microbiota in GI disorders? So dysbiosis or alterations in the intestinal microbiota has been described in different GI and systemic diseases, and in this presentation I would like to focus on four examples. Antibiotic-associated or related diarrhea, mainly C. diff colitis, inflammatory bowel disease, functional GI disorders, and colon cancer. So I picked infectious condition, inflammatory condition, functional condition, and cancer. When we talk about the microbiota in human disorders, we need to address three important questions. First, does the intestinal microbiota in patients with specific GI conditions differ from the microbiota in healthy individuals? If it does differ, then is it important, an important factor in the pathophysiology of the disorder? And if it does, Are there any clinical implications? So let's start with C. diff infection. As you heard, the pathophysiology or the suggested pathophysiology is that following exposure to antibiotics, there is alterations in the colonic microflora, which enable C. diff to colonize, produce toxin, and in the absence of adequate or protective immune response, you will get diarrhea and colitis. To emphasize the importance of the microbiota in the development of C. diff, I brought this study. So as you can see, what you see here on the left are the relative abundance of predominant phyla in healthy individuals. Here on the left, you can see that there is a significant or not significant change in patients who have initial C. diff colitis. You see that the predominant phyla pretty much stay the same. But in patients who have recurrent C. diff, you can see a significant change in the microbiota, in the structure of the microbiota. Also, if you look at the diversity of the richness of the microbiota, in the blue here, you can see high richness or high diversity in controls, somewhat lower in patients with initial C. diff, and very disturbed and lower diversity in patients with recurrent C. diff. What about IBD? On the left here is the normal homeostasis between the bacteria and the host. The current disease hypothesis, or one of them, for the development of IBD suggests that chronic inflammation in IBD results from alteration in the intestinal microbiota, what we call dysbiosis, damage to the epithelial barrier, and dysregulated immune response to the intestinal bacteria in genetically susceptible patients. And I want to give you two examples of the dysbiosis in patients with IBS, and I choose this one. What you see here is is the microbiota analysis on fecal samples from patients with Crohn's disease. On the red here, you see Crohn's colitis, and you can see that it's significantly different than patients with Crohn's and with ileal Crohn's disease, and both are different from patients with UC, which are not so separated so well from healthy controls, meaning that the intestinal microbiota differ between patients with IBD and healthy control and among patients with different IBD subtypes. But this was on fecal samples. This study was done on mucosal samples. In this study, they collected samples from areas where there was inflammation and areas without inflammation in same individuals. Individuals are marked here, hard for me to see, marked here in different numbers. First, you can see that patients with Crohn's disease separated well from patients with UC. You see the red in Crohn's disease and patients with UC in green. Also, you can see that there are differences in the microbiota between biopsies that were taken from the inflammatory mucosa versus the non-inflammatory mucosa. But overall, you can see that these differences were not consistent across patients, and that the separation between inflamed and non-inflamed tissue did not or was not more than the inter-individual variability. What about irritable bowel syndrome? The pathogenesis of irritable bowel syndrome is still unknown. Here's our suggested pathophysiological model. According to our model, the intestinal microbiota interact with the immune system. Both interact with the brain-gut axis to affect GI physiology and lead to GI symptoms. This is the results of a study that we did a while ago, focusing on patients with diarrhea-predominant IBS. You can see a significant differences between patients with DIBS and healthy control with regard to the composition of the microbiota. Of specific interest is the significant decrease in a bacteria called Fecalobacterium presnusii. And this is interesting because it is the same bacteria that was later reported to be reduced also in patients with recurrent Crohn's disease, post-surgical Crohn's disease. On Monday, tomorrow, we will present our current results looking at the association between the microbiota and IBS symptoms. It will be tomorrow in the president and plenary session. But it's not only the composition of the intestinal microbiota that matters. Here is the results of a recent study just published in the Red Journal, where we show that also the fermentation is different between patients with IBS and healthy control. Fermentation here was measured by the production of short-chain fatty acids and the pH, intraluminal pH levels. Colon cancer, again, there is more and more report of differences both in the composition and the function of the microbiota between patients with colorectal cancer and healthy control. This is a result from a fecal samples analysis. This study is of interest. It came from UNC Tope Keku's group, and what she was able to show, this was done by mucosal biopsies from patients with adenoma compared to patients without adenoma, and she was able to characterize a pattern or a cluster of a microbiota that is associated more with adenoma cases compared to non-adenoma. So, can the intestinal microbiota be targeted in the treatment of GI disorders? If you look at all the factors that affect the intestinal microbiota, three are obvious factors that we can use: diet, antibiotics, and probiotics. We now also have fecal microbial transplant, as you just heard, which is used mainly for C. diff. There are some anecdotal reports regarding other conditions, but these are not still FDA approved. You need to believe me that there is enough data showing that that diet, probiotics, antibiotics all have significant effect on the structure and function of the intestinal microbiota. But what I want you to remember are three things. First, with regard to diet, the effect is fast. Within 24 hours, we already see changes, significant changes in the microbiota. And the changes vary among individuals. You cannot expect the change in one diet or in one direction in one individual will cause the same effect with regard to the microbiota on another individual. With regard to probiotics, remember that not all probiotics are the same, and the effect are strain and condition specific. And what I mean with this is that you cannot extrapolate from studies that were done on IBS to IBD and vice versa and other conditions. What about antibiotics? The effects are long-standing. There is a long-term decrease in the bacterial diversity, which is a measure of health. And some taxa do not recover even months after treatment. Also, the antibiotic treatment reduces the resistance to colonization, and this can cause permanent changes in the structure of the microbiota, and some of them may lead to disease conditions. Who should we consider for interventions targeting the intestinal microbiota? So first, many healthy people are asking whether they should do something, take probiotics or change the diet with regard to the benefit for the microbiota. So dietary guidelines for the Americans are published by the Department of Health and Human Services and USDA every 5 years. And these serve as really as the authoritative guidelines for the diets for the population. The last guidelines were published in 2010, I'm quoting, said, the gut microbiota do play a role in health, although the research in this area is still developing and there were no specific recommendations with regard to treatment. I just logged in before coming to this meeting, and unfortunately the guidelines that are supposed to be for 2015 are not yet released and will be released later this year or the beginning of 2016, so stay tuned. There might be some suggestions with regard to their recommendations for healthy people. What about patients? So C. diff, you already heard about it. Antibiotic is the core of the treatment that we use. Probiotic may be used for prevention. And FMT is growing as a mode of intervention for patients with recurrent C. diff infections. For IBD, dietary changes, I think, make it or are used, or dietary interventions are being used more by pediatricians with quite a nice level of success. And I think that the importance of diet in IBD will grow as we will learn more also in adults. Regarding probiotics, there is some data on primary and secondary prevention of pouchitis. The data is less supportive for UC and not supportive for Crohn's disease. Antibiotic we usually use as a bridge in acute flares and in patients with perianal diseases. What about IBS in diet? A growing interest in FODMAP diet, you will probably hear about it here. Use of probiotics is way beyond what we expect. The overall effect is relatively modest, but still there may be a role for it as we will learn more. Antibiotics for IBS is gaining more and more attention, but I need to remind you again, the long-term effect of the use of antibiotics on the intestinal microbiota, particularly if you use it again and again. So, with regard to C. diff, does the intestinal microbiota differ in patients with recurrent C. diff and a healthy individual? The answer is yes. Is it an important factor in the pathogenesis? The answer is yes. Does it have clinical implication? The answer is also yes. We use broad-spectrum antibiotics, probiotics for prevention, and FMT is growing. Inflammatory bowel disease, does the intestinal microbiota differ? The answer is yes. Is it an important factor? Probably yes. Clinical implications? Not so much. Broad-spectrum antibiotics have been used mainly in patients with C. diff, with Crohn's disease. We talked about probiotics that may be beneficial in primary and secondary prevention of pouchitis, less in UC and Crohn's disease. FMT, we need more data. Irritable bowel syndrome? Yes, yes, and yes. Colon cancer, does the intestinal microbiota in patient differ? The answer is yes. Is it an important factor? We don't know. We need more data and clinical implication yet unknown. So where does it take us all? I think that the future is with ongoing research in the microbiome. I think that what we learn from the microbiome research is that the intestinal microbiota is a dynamic, functional organ with a tremendous effect on the human physiology and health. The knowledge about bacterial communities far outpaces the viral and eukaryotic communities, so most of the research these days are focusing on bacteria, but viral and eukaryote may have associated or may lead to diseases as well. Luckily, the focus is in research shifting from structure to functionality. We start to look more at the function of those bacteria and from association studies to causation. It definitely expands our understanding of GI disorders and diseases, and it may lead to new definitions of GI diseases, and it certainly can lead to new opportunities and development of diagnostic and treatment strategies as we move forward. With this, I'll stay tuned, and thank you for your attention.